Dr. Shweta Sharma from Graduate College, and today we have the outcome of the two applications of the second law of thermodynamics. But then again, we will be discussing on the third law of thermodynamics through my introduction. So just listen to that, and then we are going to do the two more important topic today. Carnot cycles and the Clausius inequality. And with the help of the notes, as usual, I'm going to explain you the topic.
Hello students, एक पार्ट जो है हमारे लिए बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट है, दैट इज़ द थर्ड लॉ ऑफ थर्मोडायनामिक्स. आज हम लोग उसके बारे में देखने वाले. वी आर ट्राइंग टू अंडरस्टैंड. I consider this third law of thermodynamics very important. You know why? Because this is the condition which is giving you an complete view towards our universe. Nernst, one of the scientists, he was into deep thought. उन्होंने अगर मैं थोड़ा सा जस्ट रिकैपिचुलेट करना चाहूँगी, जरूरत लॉ ऑफ थर्मोडायनामिक्स की ज़रूरत नहीं है. फर्स्ट लॉ ऑफ थर्मोडायनामिक्स जो था हमारा कंडीशंस था कि जैसे जैसे द टोटल एंट्रोपी रिमेंस कॉन्स्टेंट बिकॉज द एनर्जी इज कन्वर्टेड फ्रॉम वन फॉर्म टू द अदर. सिंपल लैंग्वेज में एनर्जी इज नाइदर क्रिएटेड नॉट डिस्ट्रॉयड, इट इज जस्ट चेंजिंग फ्रॉम वन फॉर्म टू द अदर. डी क्यू डी यू प्लस डी डब्ल्यू के बराबर था, तो जो भी हीट था वो उसके ये लेफ्ट हैंड साइड राइट हैंड साइड बराबर था, राइट. सो यहाँ पर था कि एंट्रोपी इज कॉन्स्टेंट. सेकेंड लॉ ऑफ थर्मोडायनामिक्स आप अगर देखेंगे तो उसका कंडीशन था कि जितनी भी है द एंट्रोपी इज ऑफ द यूनिवर्स इज इंक्रीजिंग बिकॉज इट इज़ अ स्पॉन्टेनियस प्रोसेस. स्पॉन्टेनियस मतलब डिसऑर्डरनेस और रेंडमनेस बढ़ रहा है और एंट्रोपी बढ़ता ही जाएगा. दैट इज़ वॉट वी डेल्ट विद द सेकेंड लॉ ऑफ थर्मोडायनामिक्स. ना जब बात आए कि इस तरीके से एंट्रोपी तो बढ़ता चले जाएगा, तो नर्नस्ट ने बहुत ही ज़्यादा सोचना स्टार्ट किया कि ये कैसे है. अगर कोई एक सिस्टम ले रहे हैं तो सिस्टम में जो अपना सारा चीज़ गतिविधियाँ हो रही है मॉलिक्यूल्स की यहाँ से वहाँ वहाँ से, तो होगा ही और रैंडमनेस बढ़ेगा तो एंट्रोपी बढ़ेगा. तो इन्होंने जो बात की वो था थर्ड लॉ ऑफ थर्मोडायनामिक्स के लिए, और इन्होंने कंडीशन दिया कि अगर हमारा यूनिवर्स एब्सोल्यूट जीरो में आ जाए. एब्सोल्यूट जीरो, यू ऑल अंडरस्टैंड, जीरो केल्विन यानी कि -273 डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड में, तो मॉलिक्यूल्स का मोशन सीज हो जाएगा. मतलब द मॉलिक्यूल विल स्टॉप मूविंग, एंड दिस इज द वे वी कैन हैव द एंट्रोपी, वी कैन हैव अ कंट्रोल ओवर द एंट्रोपी. सो ये बहुत ही छोटी सी बात है लेकिन बहुत बड़ी बात है, और दिस इज अ वेरी good conditions that Nernst theorem, the third law of thermodynamic is also known as the Nernst theorem. And at the same time, the attainability of absolute zero, the attainability of absolute zero, absolute zero इतना आसान नहीं है कहीं पर. आप अगर absolute zero को attain करना चाहेंगे तो lab में बहुत सारे आपको heats बाहर से देने पड़ते हैं, आपको वो conditions provide करना पड़ता. आप दे रहे हो तभी आपको वो zero Kelvin में आ रहा है. तो ये इतना आसान नहीं होता है कि आप फट सोच लो और एब्सोल्यूट जीरो ले आओ. तो ये तो बहुत सोचने वाली बात है कि हाउ वी कैन रेगुलेट, हाउ वी कैन हैव अ कंट्रोल ओवर द एंट्रोपी. सो वी विल लुक फॉर दैट कंडीशंस, एंड एट द सेम टाइम वी आर गोइंग टू हैव अ वेरी नाइस, अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टर्म दैट विल बी कमिंग अप इज व्हाट वी नोन एज हीट डेथ ऑफ द यूनिवर्स. सो लेट अस सी हाउ इट goes into the heat death of the universe. तो आज के जो क्लास में हैं, पहले तो हम लोग कार्नोट साइकिल को अच्छी तरीके से समझेंगे. क्यों? बिकॉज ये फिर से हमें वहाँ पर लेके जाएगा. कार्नोट साइकिल करेंगे, उसके बाद हम लोग थर्ड लॉ ऑफ थर्मोडायनामिक्स को देखेंगे जो नर्नस्ट थ्योरम के नाल हिसाब से दिया गया है. अटेनेबिलिटी ऑफ एब्सोल्यूट जीरो को भी देखेंगे बिकॉज इट इज़ देयर इन योर सिलेबस, एंड वी विल ऑल्सो टॉक अबाउट द हीट डेथ ऑफ द यूनिवर्स. सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद आवर क्लास.
So let's start with our first topic, that is the Carnot cycle. And in order to understand Carnot cycle, we have cut a diagram here. But the diagram is a PV graph. P is along the y-axis, V along the x-axis, and the major part already discussed here. We have already seen that in the figure If you get to see in the figure, then we have got a cycle created. And since this cycle, we have got two part of the cycle. If you get to see, this is the cycle. Okay, this is the cycle for the Carnot. Now in this case, it is a reversible. You can see here, T1, this A to B is isothermal, and again C to D is isothermal, but AD and BC are the adiabatic curves. So here the temperature for from A to B, we have the constant temperature at T1, and from C to D, we have got the constant temperature at T2. Further, the adiabatic compressions can be seen with this diagram. It's become because we have got the entropy also here. The adiabatic compression, so that the temperature rises from T2 to T1, the initial temperature of the working substance. In the entropy, this is the entropy temperature entropy diagram, and in this diagram what you can really see that an isothermal is represented by a straight line AB and parallel to the entropy, that is axis at temperature T1, which remains constant. Now there is the adiabatic BC is parallel to the temperature axis. You can see these are the adiabatic one. They are parallel to the temperature axis, right? So this is the first graph was PV graph, and the second one is the TS graph, and that is the temperature entropy graph. So here what is being noted, the increase in entropy is S2 minus S1. So this is the increase in entropy. If Q1 is the amount of heat absorbed from the source at temperature T1. So here we change at the change in entropy as equals to Q1 by T1. Q1 is the heat taken from the source and T1 is the temperature of the source. So the change in entropy formula that is being seen here is S2 minus S1 is equals to Q by T1. Of energy, heat energy converted to useful work, that is Q1 minus Q2. If we take, we are getting up this as here, and this is the area, and this is the area that we have considered ABCD. Now area of Carnot cycle on the TS diagram, the TS diagram, if you get to see, then the efficiency, this efficiency is equals to Q1 minus, this is the work done divided by the heat absorbed as the definition of efficiency. So if we substitute the entire value here, whatever we have calculated for Q1 and Q2 and Q1, so we are getting up this, and so finally we are left out with the same value. If you remember in the Carnot cycle also, when we had done, we were getting the efficiency formula as equals to 1 minus T2 by T1. T1 was the temperature of the source, T2 was the temperature of the sink. So here also, if we get to see, when we consider the entropy, there also there is hardly any change. So this temperature entropy means, if we include the entropy also, then the efficiency is not depending upon entropy. The efficiency of the engine only depends upon the temperature of the two, that is the temperature of the source and the temperature of the sink. And this is the only reason it is used in many places. This concept is used in many places, mainly in the engineering and the meteorology. The next topic that we have is called Clausius inequality. Now Clausius and inequality is again based on the second of thermodynamics entropy concept we have here, that is the close integral of dq by dt is less than or equals to zero. This is a relation between the temperature of an arbitrary number of heat reservoirs and the amount of heat transferred, that is given up or lost. Based on Clausius inequality, we have got the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Kaplan in the year 1834 and Clausius jointly, they have an important equation, and they gave this law based on the boiling point and the freezing point. So this law is based on the boiling point and the freezing point, and in order to understand, let us consider this graph. This is a PV graph again. So in the PV graph, you can see here the cycle that we had already discussed, that this is AC and this is point is D and this point is B. So if we consider the curve ABCD, so when we consider the curve, the clear, see this is A and this is B here, and then C, So what we get, it is representing two isothermals of a substance at two temperature below the critical temperature, that is T plus dT and T. Now at B and F, if you get to see at B and at F, okay. Now the substance is in the liquid state. These are the liquid states. These are the liquid states, which is at C and G is the, whereas C and G represents the vapor state. So here is the liquid and here is the vapor state. So along the line, that is BC and FG, the substance exists partly in the liquid state as well as it is acting, it is there in the vapor state also. So if we have T and T plus DT as the boiling point of the substance under pressure P and P, the change in pressure dP, then we have got for the two adiabatics, this is one of the adiabatic and this is another, that is sorry, this is one of the adiabatic and this is another adiabatic, that is CD and AB. Two adiabatics, the heat absorbed for CA is at T plus DT is the latent heat. So here we have the latent heat, and for L plus DL, the change in the latent heat, and heat given along at BT, this is in connection with the Carnot's reversible cycle. So we have the equation here, L plus DL divided by T plus DT is equals to L by T. Now, if we solve this equation and just separate the component del part and time, temperature part on the two sides of the equations, this is the equations. Then we find that the work done in the complete cycle is given by this formula. This is for the change in the latent heat. So we are getting up this as equals to L dT by T. Suppose the volume of the unit mass of the substance at B is V1 and at C it is V2. So we have got the total work done for the complete process as equals to the area, and the area is given by the change in volume and the change in pressure. So finally we are getting up this equation dP by T. dP by T is equals to, we have L by T divided by V2 minus V1. This is what is known as the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, and it is also known as Clapeyron's equation for the first latent heat equation. Now based on this, we have got the applications. The application is given for three different conditions. The first condition, when volume, the final is greater than the initial, we find that if we see the equation, we are getting dP by dT as equals to positive, and this results in the melting point of the substance. That is, with the increase in pressure, substance melting point is increasing. Now the second condition, if we have got V2 less than V1, so we get this same sign as negative, and this sign negative shows that the melting point of the substance decreases with the increase in pressure. Melting point of ice decreases with the increase in pressure. The last point, the effect of change in pressure on the boiling point. At boiling point, liquid is converted into its gaseous state, and hence the volume V2 is always greater than the corresponding V1. So this is the conditions as well as the application of the Clausius Clapeyron's equations. Hope you have understood this, and thanks for watching.